analytic thought. They have a certain sympathy for so-called continental philosophy. Many of them, it's very fashionable today. Even scientists like to refer, for example, to Spinoza. You know, Damasio wrote a book claiming Spinoza practically proto-brain scientist, so many things and so on. All of them are good. Leibniz, Bertrand Russell liked Leibniz and so on. Kant is usually delimitation. Kant is usually the last that this analytic Anglo-Saxon orientation is ready to swallow. After Kant, for them, it's just obscenity. Although, yeah. If your mind is as dirty as mine, I know you can say, but wait a minute, it's a philosopher, I know the accent is different, whose name is an obscenity, no? And this is why when I gave a talk, yes, I'm well known in my country that whenever in the line of thought there is just a slight opening towards a tasteless obscenity. I will take that road, you know. But once I was surprised, I didn't do it consciously. I gave 20 years ago at Berkeley a talk called Kant and Hitchcock. And then told me, oh, you have both of them in the... This surprised even me. I wasn't aware of that. Okay, so let's go on. So what I want to say is that... what should make you suspicious is when a certain critique paints the enemy as an openly absurd image. You know, this image of Hegel, absolute knowledge, the one who thought he can penetrate the mind of God, because, you know, somewhere he, ironically, Hegel characterizes his logic as what went on in the mind of God before the creation of the world and so on. So my hypothesis is the following one. That Hegel is a so-called vanishing mediator between traditional metaphysics and the post-Hegelian, this turn to actual reality, anti-philosophy. But I think it's not simply as people who try partially to rehabilitate Hegel, like Charles Taylor. Incidentally, his Hegel is, I think, one of the worst books on Hegel. It should be burned publicly. It's not in the sense that Hegel was in between, you know, still idealist, but already moments of historicism, historical description. No, my point is that something unique happened in Hegel, and I will spend the rest of the time today and tomorrow to try to give you at least some indications what, that something unique happened there, unthinkable. Even today, we don't really know what. So that it is not, if we try to be Hegelians today, that we behave as if the post-Hegelian break didn't happen. It's on the contrary. The entire post-Hegelian, this anti-philosophy, which is one desperate attempt to obliterate what Hegel did. Hegel went too far. And I think that it's this anti-philosophy which does this by getting rid of Hegel, how? By way of constructing this ridiculous image of Hegel, which for which I think we should use this Freudian term, you know, Deck Erinnerung, screen memory. You know, screen memory as a false, obviously ridiculous figure concealing some truly traumatic excess. I think that Hegel that we know is mostly this kind of Deck Erinnerung. A very comfortable, ridiculous image. It's easy to laugh at him, oh, that idiot, a poor employer of the Prussian Ministry of Education who thought he knows everything and so on, but was just doing some ridiculous mechanical logical reasoning. And if they concede that sometimes Hegel did have bright insights, the idea is that, yes, from time to time he had a sense of observation, he made good points, but it is all spoiled by this mechanical application of this dialectical machinery which can swallow everything. So again, what that will be my thesis, to give you some arguments for this opposite reading. That no, it's the post-Hegelian break which misses something in Hegel. And this is also, I think, in accordance with a more general historical theory, which I like. I developed it already in one of my early books that I think for the moment what they do. This idea, I took a term from Fred Jameson of vanishing mediator as a crucial figure of historical development. What is vanishing mediator? Vanishing mediator is not simply something which is a little bit here and a little bit there. You know, like you pass, for example, you pass from religious metaphoric universe, divine meaning everywhere, to modern, secular, grey, mechanic universe, and then you can nicely show how you have figures which are in between. Usually it is they already use the new terminology, but still deal with the old topic. I'm not saying there are not wonderful things which often happen here. For example, my favorite vanishing mediator between medieval universe and modern mechanical materialism is Malebranche. Read him. Oh my God, he's a genius. It's a French theologist, a pupil of Descartes, Nicolas Malebranche, who radicalized Descartes in a totally crazy way. But as often, you can find wonderful, bright insights in this total madness. The starting point of Malebranche was, you know, what was Descartes' idea, this radical dualism? We have two substances, res cogitans, the thinking substance, and res extensa, the extended material substance. Already, you can see what is missing here, life. Descartes has no space for life. For Descartes, there are only mechanisms and spirit, which is why all these holistic New Agers hate Descartes. He's the big bad guy for all of them, from Al Gore downwards. This is the worst of Al Gore, when he says Descartes guilty of everything and so on. On the contrary, I think Descartes is one of the big good guys. But okay, what did Malebranche do? Sorry for making these detours, but I'm not losing track, they are crucial. Malebranche did something, you know, then Descartes had a problem, how are the two connected? For example, in us as human beings, our soul, the thinking substance, and our body. His solution was totally ridiculous. He found, you know, he liked to do the anatomy and so on, so he found this, how do you call it, pineal gland or what, no? One gland?
Pineal, sorry,
yes. And it drew his attention because it's only one. It was the only one which was one. So he thought this is, as it were, the point of passage. It's through that gland that our soul gets impressions from the body and returns orders back to the body. Like, to put it very simply, if you decide to move, to raise your hand, you think about it, you give an order passes through this stupid gland to your nerves, and so on. It's ridiculous, obvious.
Didn't he call it the seat of the soul?
Sorry?
Didn't he call it the seat of the soul?
Yeah, the bodily seat of the soul, yes. But nonetheless, for him, the soul was substantially, totally different. He was a radical dualist. He would never have accepted that, how should I put it, the soul really is there. It's a little bit like, let me tell you another interesting philosophical story. I always had big debates with theologists. A couple of points I don't get. You know that it's very fashionable, especially for Catholics, to oppose biogenetic manipulations. No? Their story is, no, we are not just neuronal automata, we have an immortal soul, so don't mess with the brain. Now, I asked them, and I still didn't find a good answer. Maybe you will give it to me from the theological side. A very simple counter-argument. Isn't this way to reason contradictory? If you are convinced that you are not just a neuronal automata, that you have an immaterial, immortal soul, why do you worry then, what do I do with your brain? You say, fuck off, do whatever there, I'm not there, I have a soul. You